952-629-5181. ABC Frederick's Appliance.
Ocala's Information Station, 1370 WOCA. Ocala!
All right, 23 minutes before 10 o'clock, and thank you for being patient with me as we went a little long with the last interview, so I apologize for that. It made our next guest wait and probably be nervous about the phone and all that, so I apologize to her in advance, too, before we go on the air with her. Her name is Wendy McElroy, and you're going to love what she's going to talk about, but I want to introduce her this way, because I am a man, and I am a dad, and when you are a 17-year-old young man, you are perhaps looking at young women differently than when you're a 60, 50, 40-year-old father of a girl.
Yeah.
And suddenly 17-year-old boys are coming to see her, mm-hmm. right? Back then, when you were 17, all guys are good. When you're 17, you're good. He's good. All of us are good. We're not up to any harm. You know, there's a few bad apples, but, you know, that's the exception. When you're a parent of a daughter who is now seeing 17-year-old guys, they're all bad.
Yeah.
They are all up to no good. There is not a good one out there. I don't know what happened in the generation change, but they're all bad. And I say that with tongue in cheek because I don't really believe that. But sometimes we take that attitude, I think, and we actually go too far with it and start imposing it upon ourselves, really, as a human race or as a society, and putting it into our laws. And I believe Wendy is probably the best person to talk about this because, believe it or not, she is described as a feminist writer. Mm-hmm. So she has been fighting for your rights as women. Just as, by the way, most dads are.
Yeah.
Most dads want their daughters to have everything, you know, that we've always had. She's got an interesting topic: the falsification of data alleged in domestic violence research and the politically correct findings used to promote anti-male policies and programs. And let's see what this is about from Wendy McElroy. Good morning, Wendy.
Good morning to you.
Thank you for being on the air with us. Where are you?
I'm right now in Canada, outside Toronto.
Oh, okay, okay.
I'm basically representing Stop Abusive and Violent Environments, which is in Maryland. Thank you for your endorsement of, you know, women's rights, but I want men's rights and the attitude toward men to be as respected as women's. And I think there has been a swing toward basically neglecting men's rights and vilifying men with stats and studies. But what I wanted to talk to you about this morning was a 2009 study, speeches by Attorney General Eric Holder, in which he came out with the stat, and it was repeated on the Department of Justice site, that the leading cause of death for American African-American women between the ages of 15 to 45 years old was intimate partner violence, which means domestic violence, which means they were beaten to death by black men, usually. That's a shocking statistic. It tells a shocking thing about black families, about black men, about men in general. And the thing that is most shocking about it to me, however, is that it's flatly false.
Ah, I wondered if that's where you were going.
It is flatly false. A group of us who looked at that stat and said, that just seems extraordinary to us, went and actually looked into the history of it and traced it back. And when I say a group of us, one of the people was the Washington Post fact-checker, Glenn Kessler, who wrote an article on the forensic examination of this statistic in December of last year. They went back and they traced it to two 2003 studies that cited a Bureau of Justice survey. And when you went to the survey that was done in 1998, that statistic didn't exist. It just wasn't there. And meanwhile, this statistic that says that, you know, you were talking about being a father.
Right, right.
Imagine being a father of a 17-year-old, you know, African-American girl.
Right.
Going on a date and with her 18-year-old boyfriend, and putting your hands on her shoulder and say, have a good time, but sweetheart, remember, who you're dating is the leading cause of death in your generation.
Right, right. I would have no problem saying that. I mean, even if I was wrong, I would err on the side of caution, as they say.
Well, I err on the side of truth, okay? When you go back to the CDC, which is the 2008 CDC, Centers for Disease Control study, which, again, it was the 2009 statements by Eric Holder, the leading cause of death between 15 and 45 was cancer. The second was heart disease. The third, I believe, was accident. Go right down the list. And the fifth is homicides of all types. And if you extract out domestic violent homicides, it was something like seventh or eighth.
Okay, well, it's still pretty high.
It's appallingly high.
Yeah.
And I'm appalled as a woman. Nevertheless, this stat that the leading cause of black women dying between 15 and 45 is they're beaten to death by black men is simply false. And it was sensationalized.
Well, let's take that just for a second and look at that. That must have been falsified for a reason. Was that published, that fact or falsehood published, so that a law could be made that shouldn't have been made? Was it a false way of leveraging somebody's position?
It was published in two studies, as I said. 2003 studies that were the principal investigator was a lady named Jacqueline Campbell, who teaches at Johns Hopkins University and is arguably the leading domestic violence authority in America. She has been part of the World Health Organization on domestic violence studies and congressional committees, things like that. She has made a career out of these studies and these programs. There are many programs that are based on what I think are very... you want to err on the side of caution, I understand that.
Mm-hmm.
But one of the things that has happened in domestic violence is the funding, the power in terms of prestige and careers have gone basically on the premise that women are the victims of domestic violence, men are the perpetrators. All studies that you look at overwhelmingly say that it's committed by both sexes equally.
Okay, but here's the question I think I have from all of this is, if you're in a courtroom defending one defendant or prosecuting one defendant, either way, how do you use any broad brushstroke information? I mean, isn't that one person either guilty or not guilty?
No. I know that seems to be the American way and individual cases, but in fact, if you look at police policy and you look at the sort of instructions that police forces have had over the last few decades, it's you arrest the man. And very often, that they basically have taken a very biased view and proceeded with it through public policy, public programs, and in laws. One of the laws that is probably the most biased is the Violence Against Women Act. You can even hear in the name of the act that it's gender biased.
Well, yes, I've thought that about that exact thing. I've thought why isn't it just Violence Act? Why is it? I mean, if somebody's committing violence against somebody else, that's all that you need to know.
Well, one of the things that it is the reason that it's Violence Against Women Act is that's where the funding goes. I think in the United States, I believe there is one shelter that is established for men who are the victims of domestic violence, and they are turned away universally from other shelters, and there's hundreds of ones for women.
And
so
that's
where the funding goes.
Yeah.
And that is so unfair because, like you were saying about the police, even though there are a lot of women that instigate all of that physical abuse and they'll be attacking the man and attacking him, and usually the man will not fight back if the women attack them. As soon as the police get there, they're going to throw the fella in the police car.
Exactly. What you're saying is exactly true. And it gets to be even worse in attitudes, because I was on a radio program 2 days ago where the man started laughing and said, what kind of man lets a woman hit him? And, well, a man who has respect for women and doesn't want to hit back. Because the studies that say that the genders abuse about the same rate also say that when men are the abusers, the injury is far, far worse.
Well, you know, and mm-hmm. just to kind of defend what you were saying with whoever the other radio guy was, the act of hitting isn't the only way. I do the news every morning. I've had stories of women poisoning their husbands with antifreeze.
Antifreeze.
Yeah. So you can use a chemical.
Yeah.
Knives have come into the guns have come
right.
into. It's not all about fists and hands.
Mm-hmm. Absolutely. I call that domestic violence.
Yeah.
Yeah. Exactly.
Yeah, I would say if you're pouring antifreeze into his Cheerios.
That's right. That's true.
Now you've slandered a brand name.
Well, I didn't mean Cheerios. I meant Toasted O's or something. I don't know what I meant there.
And also self-esteem issues. I mean, there are women out there that just considerably tell the men they're no good, they're never going to amount to anything, they don't make enough money, and then the men have this stigma about them, and that the women get away stock-free.
Absolutely. You know, it's a strange position for a feminist to basically say, look, my sex is capable of violence and abuse as well.
Mm-hmm.
But I think that attitudes, programs, funding, and laws have been so skewed in the opposite direction that, you know, it's getting to be a position of privilege for women and a free pass.
Right.
And I don't want that either. I want responsibility.
Florida recently, maybe within the last 2 years, maybe more, changed one thing that I thought was a good thing. If an 18-year-old man was with a 17-year-old girl, then and they were having sex and it was consensual, then he would be arrested for statutory rape, which was a huge fine and a huge prison
yeah.
time back then. But they created something in our state called the Romeo and Juliet ruling or something like that, where mm-hmm. if it's consensual and the age is close enough, and I think there's like a 3-year or something like that, a 3-year margin.
Yeah.
Well, of course, you're not really talking about statutory rape. You're talking about abuse, like hitting with a frying pan or something, right?
But what you're saying goes to my point, because it was the male who was arrested. It wasn't the female.
That's true. Yeah.
If one was 16 and 15 and both were minimum, you know, under the minimum age, it would be the male that overwhelmingly was arrested.
Yes.
And not the girl.
Yes.
And I don't want either one of them arrested. My goodness. I mean, I was a teenager. I know the hormones that go on. And
yeah.
I know that you experiment with life. And the last thing you want is having a law enforcement
right.
involved in that confusing thing.
Well, the one aha moment in our discussion so far was when you referenced the funding that is a result of the Violence Against Women Act. So can we go back to that just for a second? Is that perhaps the real reason for the act in the first place, was to somehow get funding?
There is a whole domestic violence industry that's been built. That's funding, grants, careers, experts, legal system that is huge. And it is basically all directed toward women. There's another act in front of Congress right now, which is the International Violence Against Women Act. And that tries to take, I believe it is $5 billion worth of foreign aid and redirect it in a
wow.
manner that aids women. And it is, I am so appalled by this act, because the way it aids women and girls is a large part of it, for example, goes to refugee camps. And quite literally, if a child is a female and 2 years old, it gets funding. If it's a male, it does not. And it also funds the programs to stem the spread of HIV and AIDS, but only for women. Where is the rationale there? It basically takes funding, and it's that act is very much championed by Hillary Clinton and by other I call them politically correct feminists. I'm not a politically correct feminist.
Oh, thank God.
So thank you.
Well, it sounds like where you, I mean, your position sounds level-headed. It sounds like you say what's fair is, what's the old saying, the goose and the gander? You know, what's fair is fair. It shouldn't, gender or sex shouldn't have anything to do with it.
Mm-mm. A black eye doesn't have a gender. And someone who has AIDS does not have a gender, nor does someone who shows up in a refugee camp.
Right.
It seems also that if there is some kind of domestic violence in anywhere, and the woman goes to the police department or something to get a restraining order, they give it to her right away. If the man goes to get a restraining order, they're almost laughed at by the legal system.
You're absolutely right. And one of the things that, if I can plug the site that I'm representing, is Stop Abusive and Violent Environments. One of the things we've tried to do is change. I referenced the 2009 statistic that from Holder's speeches that was put on the Department of Justice. We tried for 3 years to get them to change it, just to make a correction. And finally, after we've been doing a radio campaign, and thank you so much for publicizing it, they put a very strange disclaimer at the very bottom of the page, which basically reinforced the statistics. It was like a non-disclaimer disclaimer. It was very strange. Huh. But if anyone wants to know about this, they should go to saveservices.org and everything's documented.
Could we use the information on the website if a man is, for example, in a circumstance where he feels like he's being the one dragged through the coals and something's being unfair? Does saveservices.org give him tools to help himself?
Certainly. They could direct to places that are advocates for men who are losing custody of their, when I say custody, the ability to see their children. There's a big campaign that's going on about fathers who lose the ability to adopt, to have custody of their own children because the woman chooses to adopt them out to strangers rather than let the blood father and his family have a chance to raise the child. So there's things like that are inequities in the law that saveservices.org is a fine place to start looking.
Is there a movement to try to change Dr. Campbell's mind and have her print a retraction?
Yes, and it's interesting. She is finally, after 3 years, responding to emails. But again, it's this non-disclaimer that they say that, well, yes, that this was once true, but it's not true now. It was never true. The causes of death for African-American women between 15 and 45 have been remarkably stable for decades. And that's a bad thing because one of the causes is homicide. I mean, the fifth cause is basically homicide, and that can never be seen as a good thing. But nevertheless, it's not the sensational panic fundraising thing that, you know, that it's the leading cause that black men are beating black women to death at alarming rates. And what a slander against black men.
Let me see if I can be devil's advocate a second here. Would it be fair to say, and I don't know if this is really devil's advocate, but would it be fair to say, though, that if we looked at the number of women who were hurt by men in domestic relationships, it would be a bigger, way bigger number than men that are hurt by women?
Well, in 2010, the Centers for Disease Control, their national intimate partner and sexual violence survey basically found that 6.5% of males were victimized by, you know, domestic violence, whereas 6.3% of females. Now, I consider any percent. When I say the overwhelming statistics, it's not just America. There's the recent 32 country survey came up with basically the same results. But no percentage is acceptable.
No, right.
But you know, it is not the case that that women are more victimized than men. And I hate to do that because I it's like, you know, yay team men or yay team women. It's a terrible statistic. I just want accuracy.
Yeah. The website that we want the listeners to know about is saveservices.org. Robin actually already made it easy for the listeners. If you just go to WOCA.com and go to the guest list for today, you'll see Wendy McElroy's name at the 935 slot, and the saveservices.org is already there. I believe it's even in the form of a link, right?
Mm-hmm. Yes.
So you can actually just click on it. And is the report and the other information all there too, as well?
Oh yes, believe me. When I say we've been trying for 3 years, the report's there. The Washington Post article from December is there. Our letters of complaint, because SAVE, which is the abbreviated form of Stop Abusive and Violent Environments. Mm-hmm. We've done an ethics complaint against Dr. Campbell, saying that, well, the word that was used was fabricate. The data has been fabricated, and given that laws, public policy, and public programs, tax-funded programs, are created on the basis of this, I think that's non-trivial.
Mm. And yes, definitely non-trivial.
And this seems to help law enforcement officials look at each individual domestic call with different eyes then, because that has got to be one of the most unsafest times for law enforcement officials to go out is on these domestic violence calls, because they might even get hurt.
Oh, absolutely. Absolutely. And, you know, they may get hurt by the woman. Mm-hmm. And the attitudes are the important thing, actually, because that's what drives laws. Laws cannot succeed if people don't believe in them and don't endorse the attitudes, which is why the studies and the alleged facts are so important.
Wendy, you've taken an interesting path in your life to be a feminist and to be speaking in support of men. That's a pretty cool term. It's almost like Martin Luther King Jr. He didn't want to see a role reversal. He wanted to see everybody equal.
Right.
Same to what you're saying, I think. It sounds similar to me. Wendy, thank you for being on the air with us. Again, I apologize for the problems we had at the beginning. It was all my fault. We were talking way too long to the last guest. He kept asking me questions, is what it was.
I have no problem blaming you.
Well, that's fine. I'm okay with it.
There you go.
SaveServices.org. There is no book to promote right now. It's just a website. And if you're a man and you're in trouble, you might want to look at it. SaveServices.org. But if you're a man and you really hurt somebody, then you deserve whatever you're getting.
Yeah. Women, too.
Put it that way. Yeah.
Women deserve it, too, if they hurt somebody.
Yeah. Wendy, thank you for what you're doing and for being on the air to share it with us.
Oh, thank you very much. It was a pleasure.
Thank you. All right, we'll take a break and be right back.
You're listening to WOCA News Talk 1370, Ocala's source for what's happening in today's hottest, up-to-date news and topics.
Trauma care centers save thousands of Florida lives.
But Shands UF wants to close Ocala Regional's Trauma Center.
An out-of-town hospital that receives millions in taxpayer money is suing to shut down Ocala's Trauma Center. They want to pull the plug on life-saving trauma care all over Florida. Don't let them get away with it. Trauma care increases the chance of survival in traumatic injuries by 25%. 25%.
That's right. But only 2 in 5 Floridians have the access to trauma care they need. And that's not even close to good enough.
We don't need less access to trauma care. We need more.
It's time for Shands UF to stop putting profits ahead of patients.
Stop playing political games.
Visit SaveOurTraumaCenters.org to find out how you can help keep Ocala's Trauma Center open and protect life-saving trauma care. Save more lives. Save our trauma centers. Paid for by the 60 Plus Association.
Your home is safe, or is it? AA Lock, Dock, and Security. The name has been a staple in Ocala since 1985. Do you have the right equipment in place to have peace of mind when you are at home or away? AA Lock, Dock, and Security has the right people to install and monitor your home or business. Call today for a free on-site security analysis. Call 867-1965. AA Lock, Dock, and Security, 219 Northwest 10th Street, 867-1965.
If you didn't catch Around the Water Cooler on Buddy's sports page this week, here's what you missed.
You guys want to tackle that that issue of this weekend, the games that you'd like to pay to see?
Yeah, I love this. This is a pair of mano-a-mano matchups. One featuring quarterbacks, the other one featuring coaches. I mean, Brady and Manning goes as far back as just about anybody in this room as far as a great quarterback rivalry. And then you've got Harbaugh and Carroll on the sidelines that goes all the way back to college.
Around the Water Cooler, Tuesdays and Thursdays at 5 o'clock on Buddy's Sports Page.
Do black patent leather shoes really reflect up? Find out at the Ocala Civic Theater's delightful musical comedy running from February 6th to March 2nd.
Watch from late bloomer Eddie Ryan's first day of Catholic school to the senior prom.
This musical romp goes through confession, poodle skirts, guardian angels, gym class, rock and roll, and the birds and the bees.
Do black patent leather shoes really reflect up? Is set for performances from February 6th till March 2nd at the Ocala Civic Theater. It's a divine comedy directed by Greg Thompson.
Who?
Yeah, that guy. He's an actor or something.
I don't know.
Last year, over $1 billion, that's a B with nine zeros, was left on the table from taxes not done right. But thankfully, H&R Block tax preparers have over 100 hours of training to help you get your piece of the billion back. Come visit us and our friends at H&R Block this tax season at the Paddock Mall, Marion Oaks, and Triple Crown Shopping Centers to make sure you get your maximum refund. Don't forget to check with your favorite nonprofit for referral information where applicable.
Hey everybody, this is Kelly Hart, your new host of the Ocala Magazine Radio Show. Join me every Friday at 10 a.m. when we bring the pages of Ocala Magazine to life with in-depth interviews from and about your community. So don't miss Marion County's favorite city magazine, Ocala Magazine, every Friday at 10 a.m. right here on 1370 AM and 96.3 FM, WOCA, The Source.
Stay informed on everything going on in the villages with the Village Spectator newspaper. The Village Spectator is exclusively devoted to the villages with news, commentary, and more. And yes, they have Tom's Picks, a free referral for people who are looking for a company to do work for them. Tom's Picks will refer the company that fits your needs, and all we ask is that you tell them where you heard about them. Call Tom's Picks at 804-1223 and pick up your copy of the Village Spectator today.
Now read Ocala Downtown Newspaper online.
Trauma care centers save thousands of Florida lives.
But Shands UF wants to close Ocala Regional's Trauma Center.
An out-of-town hospital that receives millions in taxpayer money is suing to shut down Ocala's Trauma Center. They want to pull the plug on life-saving trauma care all over Florida. Don't let them get away with it. Trauma care increases the chance of survival in traumatic injuries by 25%. 25%.
That's right. But only 2 in 5 Floridians have the access to trauma care they need. And that's not even close to good enough.
We don't need less access to trauma care. We need more.
It's time for Shands UF to stop putting profits ahead of patients.
Stop playing political games.
Visit SaveOurTraumaCenters.org to find out how you can help.